How in the world does a boat float?
How in the world does a light bulb work?
How in the world does a bird fly?
Where in the world is the deepest spot in the ocean?
Why in the world is the sky blue?
Where in the world are the seven ancient wonders?
Where in the world are the northern lights?
How in the world does the moon affect the tides?
How in the world does an electoral college work?
How in the world do bits and bytes work on the computer?
How in the world do fish breathe?
How in the world does a bridge work?
Hey there, adventurers eager to learn new things. Welcome aboard the Airship Curiosity, where we will travel all over the world to discover how in the world. And speaking of how in the world, this is a well overdue episode, but that's because we've been sprucing things up around here. As you can see, we've remodeled the interior of the airship and, well, me. Just check out the flight suit. And wait until you see the new lab for Professor Phineas Omnibus. You'll see that in a bit when he presents a new brain gain activity. But first, I know that you've got some great questions, so let's get started with the first one.
Hi, Pilot Lindy. I have a question for you. What in the world is flameworking?
Flameworking? Sounds like something firefighters do when they're responding to the scene of a fire, doesn't it? But this is just one hot technique in the art world. Let's take a look.
Okay, so I'm going to be talking about a process called flameworking, which is a little bit different than furnace work or offhand blowing. And flameworking originates with the flame. There's a stationary torch. Our torches are powered by propane and oxygen, and you get this blue flame. This flame is about 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. And what we do is we take both glass tubing and glass rod, we melt it directly in this open flame, and we manipulate it. So you can blow with tubing, or you can sculpt with solid glass. And I'm going to be showing you a bead today, a bead making process. So one of the main differences between offhand blowing or furnace blowing and flame working is that at the furnace, you generally start with an amorphous blob on the end of a long hollow tube or pipe and then shape it from there. Here, we begin with some raw materials that have been extruded by a machine. We use both tubing, which is hollow, as well as solid rod. But again, these are typically, these days, this has been extruded by a machine, although traditionally it would have been taken from the furnace and pulled out by hand. So over the years, plate glass or window glass was made a variety of different ways, and it was originally made by hand. But sometime during the Industrial Revolution, the float glass process was created, and that's how all modern plate glass and flat glass is made. This is a process where molten glass is actually floated, that's what it's called, float glass, on a layer of molten tin. And that molten tin is perfectly flat, and since it's hot, it doesn't put any marks on the glass. And then the glass is slowly fed onto a conveyor belt that cools it off slowly, and then it's cut into shapes for windows and those sorts of applications. So I have some examples of items that were flame worked here. There's some beads, which is what I'm going to be showing you on the torch today, and also marbles. So these are really small scale. You can see they have a hole going right through them there. One thing about working on the torch is you can get very intricate and do very intricate details, such as these small dots that are on the beads here. I also have a piece which is a process that's called networking, where you take small diameter rod, you bend it, you shape it, and then you can weld it back together, almost like working with metal. This is a piece made by one of our instructors here, Julia Rogers. Yet another example of flame working is a neon light, and this one actually says light. It was created by one of our instructors here, Hannah Kirkpatrick. So it's a hollow tube that's been bent into this form, and she's attached what are called electrodes on either side. Through this small tube, they're going to evacuate all the air, basically create a vacuum, and then put into it neon gas, seal it off, and then connect electricity to the electrodes, which will, of course, make the light glow. We are part of the Chrysler Museum of Art. We're part of the education department. And our mission here in the studio is one of education. We're here to educate the public about glassmaking processes as well as about the material itself, rather than creating a product. So rather than selling glass products, we sell experience. You can come to a demonstration for free, or you can take a class, try the process yourself, and actually go home with something that you've created.
Flameworking is also known as lampworking because artists used oil-fueled lamps. Did you know that the earliest discovered lampwork glass is considered a collection of beads thought to date back to the 5th century BC? It was widely practiced in Italy in the 14th century and in the 19th century. The process was used to produce paperweights in France, where it became a popular art form. When we return, we're going to travel to see the new Brain Gain Laboratory and find out why Professor Phineas Omnibus is so sunny side up these days. Stick around, we'll be right back.
Wait, wait, don't go away. How in the world? We'll be right back.
Welcome to class, students.
Hi.
Today, we're gonna learn about dog poop. Disgusting, but important. Now, what should every pet owner do?
Scoop the poo.
And how do they do that?
With plastic baggies.
And why is it important?
Because it's the right thing to do and it's the law.
Plus, nobody likes to step in it. Class is dismissed.
Yay!
Cleaning up after your pet is elementary. Do it everywhere and every time. It's as simple as that.
Welcome back, adventurous ones. A quick question for you. Why was the chicken team so bad at baseball? They kept hitting foul balls. What does that have to do with today's brain gain activity? Well, let's visit the Brain Gain Lab, where Professor Phineas Omnibus rules the roost and will demonstrate an activity that will have you crowing.
And now, another How in the World Brain Game.
Welcome, explorers. I'm Professor Phineas Omnibus, and today we're going to explore sound on vibrations. This will also make you the hit of any party. Do you go to parties? Professor Omnibus never gets invited to parties. Pilot Lindy gets to go to all the parties. Here's what you will need. A plastic drinking cup. Yarn or cotton string. Nylon string will not work well. One paper clip. A paper towel about the size of a dollar bill. A nail. Or a screw with a sharp tip on it. And water. We're going to make chicken sounds from the cup. In other words, a cup that will cluck. Cut a piece of yarn or string about 20 inches long. Ask an adult to use the nail or screw to carefully punch a hole in the center of the bottom of the cup. Tie one end of the yarn to the middle of the paper clip. Now, here comes the tricky part. Push the other end of the yarn through the hole in the cup and pull it through. Next, get a piece of paper towel about the size of a dollar bill. Then fold it once and get it damp in the water. We'll use the extra here to make it work right. Remember to always clean up if you make a mess. Your mother will thank you. She might even make you a Wiener Schnitzel. There's veal schnitzels in it. Now it's time to make some
noise.
Hold the cup firmly in one hand and wrap the damp paper towel around the string near the cup. While you squeeze the string, pull down in short jerks so that the paper towel tightly slides along the string. If all goes well, you hear a chicken. We'll try that again. Astounding! How does this work? This is an example of how a sounding board works. The vibrations from the string would be almost silent without the cup, but when you add the cup, it spreads the vibrations and amplifies them, making them louder. Pianos and music boxes, they use wood to act as a sounding board to make the instrument louder. So, get some friends together and create some clucking cups. I bet your folks will think that you've really flown the coop. Until the next time, I'm Professor Phineas Omnibus.
And what do you call a chicken crossing the road? Why, poultry in motion. Thanks, Professor. Remember, kids, get your parents' permission before trying something like that. Coming up, see what it takes to train valuable and furry members of the police department. We'll be right back with more How in the World.
Wait, don't go away. How in the World, we'll be right back.
'Cause nothing ever gonna make this world better if we don't start believing that love really, really, really is the answer. Everybody join hands, 'cause it's time now.
Old man Hennessy's window.
Correction, dude. You broke. I just threw the ball.
This is really bad. What are we gonna do?
Dude, kiss your life goodbye.
Sorry, kids.
Keep smiling. Keep shining.
Hi. Tell him it was an accident, and we can fix the window. I'll come with you.
Welcome back aboard the Airship Curiosity, and you're just in time for our next question.
Hi, Pilot Lindy. I was just wondering, how do policemen train police dogs?
A police dog, or canine, is a dog that is specifically trained by police and law enforcement personnel in their work, such as searching for drugs and explosives, searching for lost people, and protecting their handlers. But how are they trained to do all that? Let's investigate the answer. To get to the doggone truth of how canines are prepared for police work, we drop by the Virginia Beach, Virginia Police Dog Facility. Here at any given time, a number of dogs are being put through their paces before they earn their badge and the distinction, police dog.
The dogs are so important for police work, really, because they're a force multiplier for us. The dogs can do so much more work by themselves that would require multiple officers to do.
Dogs fill many police roles: drug detection, sniffing out explosives, searching and patrol work. Regardless of the role, it takes a particular kind of dog.
The kind of dogs that are most suited for police work are dogs with high drives. That's what we're looking for. If the dog has high drives, you can manipulate those drives to get them to do what you want, from obedience to detection work to bite work or anything along those lines.
Typically, police departments use three breeds of dogs for police work: German Shepherds, Belgian Malinois, and Dutch Shepherds, perfectly suited for patrol. The dogs are purchased from vendors in the United States, but most come from Europe where they are bred and sometimes trained for this type of work. So once the right dog is found...
We bring them back here. They're what we call green dogs at that time. They have very minimal training, usually some obedience and maybe a little bit of bite work.
A green dog is a young, inexperienced dog with little to no training. This works well for police as the dog has developed no bad habits. And so the training begins.
There's certain things that they have to pass for certifications, so we're training them to pass those certifications, and then we're basically getting them ready to deploy on the street to use in that capacity.
Here's an interesting fact. A police dog's commands are spoken in the language of the dog's native country. If the dog is Dutch, the handlers speak Dutch. If they're from Germany, German is used.
And the reason we do that is kind of twofold. Some people think it's so the bad guy can't call our dog off, but that's really not the case. It's just easier to teach them in their mother tongue. They've already learned commands in that language, so why reinvent the wheel?
Perhaps the most important part of training is the bite. You've seen it in movies and TV shows where the dog chases down the bad guy and pulls him to the ground by biting on the chest or leg.
The dog's going probably for the biggest body part that's presenting itself, but typically on a male standing up or running away, we usually generally have him hit in the front chest area or in the back tricep. And it's just a matter of conditioning the dog, where to bite.
That's no puppy love there.
So we have to kind of condition the dog where we want him to go, and it's just repetitive training over and over and over to get the dog to go where you want them to go. But they'll typically just target the first and largest piece that they can get to.
Police canine, if you're inside the field, sound off, face the dog, you will be bit, final warning.
Through it all, handler and dog become strong partners, both on and off the job.
The dogs become very, very responsive to their handlers, and the reason behind that is because we have them train together, work together all day long, then they go home with the handlers at night, they live with the handler and their families. But typically a police work dog will work until he's about 9 years old, is the median, I guess. Some will work a little longer, some work a little shorter. And then at that point when they're ready, we think they're ready to retire, the handler that has them will have first dibs on keeping the dog. And typically the handlers all keep the dogs that they've been working with all the years. And they'll retire them at home, and then the handler will be assigned a new dog and train a brand new dog.
And that's a cycle that gives a trusty old servant a new leash on life.
Dogs from Europe are often given commands in their native language. Many people think this is so no one besides the handler can accidentally give them an attack command in English. That's a myth. The real reason is much simpler. The dogs were trained with those command words, and it's much easier for the officer to learn a few Dutch or German words than to retrain the dog with new commands. With that, we'll begin planning our next adventure where we'll take some more of your great questions, like how in the world do we stay balanced on our bicycles, or how in the world does a tire hold air? Why in the world aren't there any more dinosaurs? Why in the world aren't there no dinosaurs?